Blackstone Audiobooks presents
Till We Have Faces, A Myth Retold by C.S. Lewis. This book is read by Wanda McCaddon. The book is dedicated to Joy Davidman. Book 1, Chapter 1. I am old now and have not much to fear from the anger of gods. I have no husband, nor child, nor hardly a friend through whom they can hurt me. My body, this lean carrion that still has to be washed and fed and have clothes hung about it daily, with so many changes, they may kill as soon as they please. The succession is provided for. My crown passes to my nephew. Being, for all these reasons, free from fear, I will write in this book what no one who has happiness would dare to write. I will accuse the gods, especially the god who lives on the grey mountain. That is, I will tell all he has done to me from the very beginning, as if I were making my complaint of him before a judge. But there is no judge between gods and men, and the god of the mountain will not answer me. Terrors and plagues are not an answer. I write in Greek, as my old master taught it to me. It may some day happen that a traveller from the Greek lands will again lodge in this palace and read the book. Then he will talk of it among the Greeks, where there is great freedom of speech, even about the gods themselves. Perhaps their wise men will know whether my complaint is right, or whether the god could have defended himself if he had made an answer. I was Orual, the eldest daughter of Trom, king of Glome. The city of Glome stands on the left hand of the river Shenet, to a traveller who is coming up from the southeast, not more than a day's journey above Ringol, which is the last town southward that belongs to the land of Glome. The city is built about as far back from the river as a woman can walk in the third of an hour, for the Shenet overflows her banks in the spring. In summer, there was then dry mud on each side of it, and reeds and plenty of waterfowl. About as far beyond the ford of the Shenet as our city is on this side of it, you come to the holy house of Ungit, and beyond the house of Ungit, going all the time east and north, you come quickly to the foothills of the Grey Mountain. The god of the Grey Mountain, who hates me, is the son of Ungit. He does not, however, live in the house of Ungit, but Ungit sits there alone. In the furthest recess of her house where she sits, it is so dark that you cannot see her well, but in summer enough light may come down from the smoke holes in the roof to show her a little. She is a black stone, without head or hands or face, and a very strong goddess. My old master, whom we called the Fox, said she was the same whom the Greeks call Aphrodite, but I write all the names of people and places in our own language. I will begin my writing with the day my mother died, and they cut off my hair, as the custom is. The Fox, but he was not with us then, said it is a custom we learned from the Greeks. Bata, the nurse, shore me and my sister Redival outside the palace at the foot of the garden which runs steeply up the hill behind. Redival was my sister, 3 years younger than I, and we two were still the only children. While Bata was using the shears, many other of the slave women were standing round, from time to time wailing for the queen's death and beating their breasts. But in between they were eating nuts and joking. As the shears snipped and Redival's curls fell off, the slave said, "Oh, what a pity! All the gold gone!" They'd not said anything like that while I was being shorn. But what I remember best is the coolness of my head and the hot sun on the back of my neck when we were building mud houses, Redival and I, all that summer afternoon. Our nurse, Butter, was a big-boned, fair-haired, hard-handed woman whom my father had bought from traders who got her further north. When we plagued her, she would say, "Only wait till your father brings home a new queen to be your stepmother. It'll be changed times for you then. You'll have hard cheese instead of honey cakes then, and skim milk instead of red wine. Wait and see." As things fell out, we got something else before we got a stepmother. There was a bit of frost that day. Redival and I were booted, we mostly went barefoot or sandaled, and trying to slide in the yard, which is at the back of the oldest part of the palace, where the walls are wooden. There was ice enough all the way from the byre door to the big dunghill, what with frozen spills of milk and puddles and the stale of the beasts, but too rough for sliding. And out comes Butter, with the cold reddening her nose, calling out, "Quick, quick! Ah, you filthies! Come and be clean, then, unto the king. You'll see who's waiting for you there. My word, this'll be a change for you."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.